I am Reverend Elea Kemler, minister of First Parish Church of Groton, Massachusetts.
And I'm Lee Kinvey, intern minister. We are so glad you're here. We are a community seeking to deepen spiritually, to take care of one another, and to be a blessing to the world. Unitarian Universalism is a faith for all. So whoever you are, whatever country you come from, whoever you love, whatever you've done, whatever your abilities, challenges, or gifts, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here in this virtual, at the moment, but very real community.
This morning, we welcome you to the minister's study instead of the minister's living room. Lee and I are fully vaccinated now, and we are so grateful to finally be in the same place at the same time to safely lead worship together. Members of the Welcoming All group are on the chat this morning, and they would love to say hello to you by name. Please write in and tell us that you are here and tell us how you are. If you'd like more information about First Parish Church, about our programs, events, and small groups, just email welcome@uugroton.org and someone will get you connected. Thank you to everyone contributing to today's service, as always, to Shawn McCann, Director of Music Ministries at First Parish, to Kevin Pammett and Meredith, whose voices you will hear later in the service, and to our Director of Religious Education, Liz Davis Chafin, who created the song video with assistance from Bailey Chafin and Cindy Primrue. And thank you to the youth choir, and finally to the musical group Wind Chimes, which is Sue Gleason and Nancy Peters.
The sanctuary we create together during this time is real. We hope you'll come inside and rest for a while to receive hope and strength. As has become our tradition, I'll ring our meditation bell and invite you to take three long, slow, deep breaths. Consider each breath, each tone, an invitation to become quieter in yourself, to open space for this moment. Breathing once for yourself.
In Judaism, there is a special prayer for when you do something you haven't done in a long time, or when a holiday comes around again, or a new season, or even when you taste something wonderful you haven't tasted for a while. It is called the Shehekianu. And it is also said when you are doing something joyful for the first time, when you feel like you've survived something, or you are doing something brave or adventuresome. Since Lee and I are here together for the first time leading worship from the same space, this feels like a good morning to say the Shehekianu prayer. Baruch Ata Adonai, Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Shehekianu, V'Kiyomanu, V'Higianu, Lazman Hazeh. And it roughly means, blessed are you, Spirit of Life, who has sustained us and brought us to this new season. In other words, thank you. Thank you that we have come through and that we are alive for this moment. So our words for chalice lighting this morning are by Leslie Ahuva Fales, They are titled All That We Have Been, All That We Will Become. Lee and I will read it together, and you will hear that there is a Shehekianu in the last verse.
All that we have been separately and all that we will become together is stretched out before and behind us, like stars scattered across a canvas of sky. We stand at the precipice, arms locked together like tandem skydivers, working up the courage to jump. Tell me, friends, what have we got to lose?
Our fear of failure, our mistrust of our own talents. What have we got to lose? A poverty of the spirit, the lie that we are alone. What wonders await us in the space between the first leap and the moment our feet, our wheels, however we move our bodies across this precious earth, touch down softly on unknown soil.
What have we got to lose that we can't replace with some previously unimaginable joy? Blessed are you, Spirit of Life, who has sustained us, enlivened us, and enabled us to reach this moment. Give us courage in our leaping and gratitude in our landing.
So we light our chalice this morning for all that we are becoming. Give us courage in our leaping and gratitude in our landing. So now let's sing together Spirit of Life by Carolyn McDade. We sing it first in Spanish, translated by Lilia Cuervo and Ervin Barrios, and then in English. And there's a link to the words in the description box so you can sing along. And Kevin Pammett is leading the singing today.
Fuente de amor, ven hacia mí y al corazón, cántale con pasión. Sopla al volar, sube en la mar, hasta moldear la justicia. La vida, arriágame, libérame, fuente de amor, ven a mí, ven a mí. Spirit of life, come unto me, sing all the stirrings of compassion, blow in the wind, rise in the sea, move in the hand, giving life the shape of justice. Roots hold me close, wings set me free.
Thank you so much, Kevin. So now I'd like to talk to the children for a little bit. First, let's say our words for gathering together. Say them with me and we'll do the hand motions. We are Unitarian Universalists with minds that think, hearts that love, and hands ready to help. So today, the story is called In a Jar by Deborah Marcero. This is a new book, and I hope you like it. I like it a lot. Llewellyn was a collector. He collected things in jars. When he held a jar and peered inside, Llewellyn remembered all the wonderful things that he had seen and done. So you can see that he has a little jar full of autumn leaves, and he's holding the jar and remembering all the leaves coming back. Llewellyn collected small, ordinary things like buttercups, feathers, and heart-shaped stones. I know somebody who collects heart-shaped stones. Cindy does. I bet there are others too. One night, the sunset painted the sky the color of tart cherry syrup. Llewellyn ventured down to the shore with as many jars as he could carry. A little girl named Evelyn was there too. Llewellyn scooped that cherry light into his jars, and when he was done, he gave one to Llewellyn. He gave one to Evelyn. So there he is giving Evelyn a jar of red cherry syrup light. Evelyn took the jar home, and to her surprise, it glowed all through the night with the memory of that sunset. Can you see it's glowing? From then on, Llewellyn and Evelyn collected things together. They collected things hard to hold, like rainbows, the sound of the ocean, and the wind just before snow falls. They collected things you might not think would even fit in a jar, but somehow they did. They collected the wonders of winter. And if you look carefully in these jars, you can see things like hot cocoa and a cardinal and a fox and an owl. And there they are skiing and ice skating. They collected the newness of spring. And in the jars, there's a baby fox and some tadpoles and some buttercups and a duck and some ducklings and rain. They collected the long days and shadows of summer. Over time, their jars filled the walls of Llewellyn's house. But one day, Evelyn had sad news. Her family was moving to a new town. Too soon, it was time to say goodbye. With Evelyn gone, Llewellyn's heart felt like an empty jar. One night, Llewellyn lay awake. Falling stars glittered against the dark sky, and he wondered if Evelyn could see them too. And that gave him an idea. Llewellyn tiptoed out into the moonless night and collected the meteor shower in a jar. The next day, he prepared a package, and you can see that he's mailing the package to Llewellyn. And when the box arrived and Evelyn opened the jar, the stars in the night sky fell all around her. Evelyn knew just what to do. She collected the sounds and the crowds and the bright night lights of her new home in the city and sent them all to Llewellyn. You can see there's a jar full of loud noises, beeping and clacking and clip and clicking. And so, when the golden leaves of autumn began to fall once again, Llewellyn set out to collect a jarful for Evelyn. A little boy named Max was there too. Luckily, Llewellyn had brought an extra jar. The end. I wonder if you could collect some of the wonderful things that you have seen and experienced and done in jars. What would they be? And if you could collect small, ordinary things, what would those be? Think about that this week. And maybe you will even pick up a stone you love, or a leaf, or some rainwater, and put it in a jar of your own. And if you do, I hope that you will tell me about it, or maybe even take a picture of it to share. So we have a song video for you now. Meredith Hill wrote and recorded a song about some of the things that she loves and misses right now, some of the things that she can't wait to share. And Liz created the wonderful video with help from Bailey and Cindy Premru. And one special thing to know is that the art in this video is what we call pew pouch art. Pew pouches are the soft little containers that we have in each pew here in the sanctuary, and they have quiet toys in them, including paper and pencils and crayons. And people, both kids and grown-ups, like to draw during the service, and they often leave their art in the pouch. So a few years ago, Jackie Fry collected a whole bunch of pew pouch art, and Liz used some of it to make this. Enjoy.
Crying is overrated. I only ever cry to show that I care. Funny thing is that I don't even care now. I can't feel anything. But what I can do, I will do. I'll shuffle through my day, making eyes shine and teeth grin and wishing. They're hung up on my wall. Water bottles lining my floor. I picture daisy flip-flops and the smell of summer grass. Lavender scented soap leaks through the cracks. And I'll pick up flowers, spray them. And
you so much. Our reading this morning is by Mary Oliver. It's her famous poem, Wild Geese. You do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert repenting. You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. Tell me about despair, yours, and I will tell you mine. Meanwhile, the world goes on. Meanwhile, the sun and the clear pebbles of the rain are moving across the landscapes, over the prairies and deep trees, the mountains and rivers. Meanwhile, the wild geese, high in the clean blue air, are heading home again. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over, announcing your place in the family of things. I'm going to invite us now into a time of quiet, into a spirit of meditation and prayer and opening, as we bring awareness of our breath more deeply into our bodies, bring a tender sense of holding, a gentling. I'll pause twice during this time, and if you're with us here on Sunday morning, I invite you to share in the chat. First, your sorrows and concerns, anything that weighs on you, so we can hold it with you. The second invitation will be for your joys, your good news and gratitude, so that it can be magnified in the sharing. If you're here with us at another time, I encourage you to name for yourself whom and what you are holding right now. In the presence of this strong and tender community, and in the shelter of this faith, we open and extend our loving embrace across time and across distance. Let us pray for all who are sick or injured in body or mind, and all who are suffering under heavy cloaks of worry or grief. We pray for the loved ones of every human who has died since the pandemic began, each life precious, each person missed. We pray and offer our gratitude to all medical workers and all those who work in hospitals and rehabs, in long-term care facilities and hospices, shelters. We pray for parents, especially those who struggle to feed their kids. We pray for and offer gratitude to our first responders, our teachers and aides, for grocery store and pharmacy employees, and for everyone who grows and helps bring food to our tables. We pray for the health and protection of this beautiful planet, and for all the more than human life. And we bear witness to and hold in our hearts and speak with love and reverence the names of people recently lost to racist violence, gun violence, and the intersection of these two. Adam Toledo, Dante Wright, Matthew R. Alexander, Samaria Blackwell, Amarjeet Johal, Jasvinder Kaur, Jasvinder Singh, Amarjeet Sikhon, Carly Smith, John Weisert, and Matthew Zadok Williams.
In the words of Reverend Al Sharpton from his eulogy for George Floyd, we won't rest until we get justice, until we have one standard of justice. Your family is going to miss you, George, but your nation is going to always remember your name, because your neck was the one that represented all of us, and how you suffered represents our suffering. We're going to fight on. And within our church community, we hold that today is the third anniversary of June Johnson's death. We hold Steve and all who loved June in our hearts today. We pray for Krista's family after the death of her uncle Don. We pray for Eric E., who is recovering and doing well after a rough week that included the installation of a pacemaker. We pray for Barbara's grandchild, Freya, who is currently in Costa Rica and has COVID. We pray for Karen, who is currently hospitalized post-surgery. We pray for Steve B., who is having some heart issues as well as Parkinson's. We pray for Irv's brother, Tom, and for Wendy, who is coping with cancer. And if the chat is available to you now, please share what's on your heart. As a community, we also celebrate together. We recognize our joy and our gratitude. We give thanks for all that sustains us, for the vaccine and each person able to receive it, for being able to have church together, at least two or three of us, for the people and places and moments that strengthen our connections, bring us laughter and joy, bring us what's new and fresh and delightful. We're grateful that Doris and Alan King are safely back home in Groton after wintering in Florida. And what are you feeling grateful for? What is sparking your delight? Share it in the chat if you can so we can magnify your joy. We witness and we hold so much. As we open and connect with one another and with ourselves and with whatever wise witness we carry inside, may we contact the deep and luminous presence of love. Love blazing through us, the love surrounding us, the love connecting us each with all. There's ample, spacious grace here for all that we are holding, for all that is true. In the days to come, whenever we feel knocked about or adrift or shut down, may we return to whatever love and connection we can find in everything that fills us with love and brings us alive and reminds us we are not alone. As we breathe, we move forward, continuing to become what we love, continuing to kneel and touch the ground, continuing to open and allow the soft, warm animals of our bodies to feel their welcome, their refuge, their belonging, right here, right now, in this love, in this family of things. Amen. We are now blessed with members of our youth choir singing the amazing song, We Rise by Batya Levine.
We rise, humbly hearted rise, won't be divided, rise, with spirit to guide us, rise, in hope, in prayer, we find ourselves here.
First, I would invite all of you to take a second and hit the like button, which is a funny thing to do on a church service, but it helps others who are in search of a religious community such as ours to find us on the vast internet. All are encouraged and invited to attend coffee and conversation on Zoom following the postlude music. It will last for 30 minutes, and the link to the Zoom meeting will be on the screen. If you are local, please come to our weekly vigil for Black Lives today and every Sunday from 1 to 2. We gather on Main Street in front of the Church Common to be in witness to the preciousness of Black lives. Our witness continues to be needed. So I hope you will join us if you can. practicing generosity is important, not just for the financial well-being of our congregation, but for our own spiritual well-being. The goal for our spring ask fundraiser was $30,000, and we have surpassed our goal, which is so amazing. And anything extra we raise will help to strengthen our financial health, to allow us to pay our fair share of dues to the Unitarian Universalist Association, which has provided such amazing support during this pandemic year. And it allows us to sustain the work of this community, which is to deepen spiritually, to take care of each other, and to be a blessing to this world. Donations in any amount may be made on the church website, www.uugroton.org. Just click on the Spring Ask button. I am so grateful for your generosity. So one of the things that I did not know about being solidly middle-aged is that the changes never stop. I thought they did. I thought at some point we're just adults, grown up, and the growing part is mostly over, the becoming mostly done. We get older, of course, if we are lucky, and hopefully a little bit wiser and maybe more patient, and maybe we get a bigger perspective, a wider view. But I thought the dramatic shifts stopped happening. Both the external life-shaking events and the internal upheavals too. And of course, it does not work this way. Now, as someone who got married again at the age of 52, maybe this shouldn't come as a surprise, but it keeps surprising me. It surprises me that my children will soon be 18 and I will be the parent of young adults. It surprises me that health issues have started coming up in conversations on a regular basis at Zoom cocktail hours. And I peer at myself in the mirror, or worse yet, in the computer camera, and I see the clear signs that I am not 25 anymore, and yet I am still becoming. I am still becoming myself. The other thing that surprises me is that I am far less in charge of this process of becoming than I would prefer. I have a pretty clear description in my own mind of the person I would like to become. Someone who is an excellent cook and gardener, someone who knows how to knit and wraps presents beautifully and plays the violin, someone who reads a lot more theology than I actually do, who does not finish everything seconds before the deadline, someone who stays in better touch with family and arrives places 5 minutes early instead of 5 minutes late. Someone who does not park their car like a bank robber who needs to make a quick getaway. Now, it's not that this person is completely out of my grasp. I know I can learn things if I am determined and committed and I practice a lot. I have knit several rows of bright red yarn under my daughter's guidance. It looks like a blanket for a pencil or an earthworm. I have progressed to not killing plants within 2 weeks of them entering my house. I now have three plants, which were Shirley Mann's, a beloved member of our congregation who died this year. And I am carefully tending those plants. I actually look things up about them on Google. I water the prayer plant with warm water and dry off its leaves because that is what it prefers. Never in my life have I done this, but I don't want to disappoint Shirley. But the truth is this. This violin playing, creative and yet orderly, learned, on time person is not who I am becoming. That is just a version of myself that I think is better and more complete than the one I am now. And I don't think that's how becoming actually works. Mary Oliver's poem, Wild Geese, has been a touchstone for me for 3 decades now. It reminds me of something I deeply believe is true, which is that even in the midst of our becoming, even in our unfinished, highly imperfect current states of being, even in the mess of the present moment, and even in our loneliness and moments of deep despair, we are enough and we belong. We belong to this earth. We belong to each other. We belong to the family of things. Mary Oliver writes, "You do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert, repenting. You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting. Over and over announcing your place in the family of things." The Irish poet David White has a beautiful way of thinking about becoming. He believes, as he puts it, that creation is waiting breathlessly for each of us to take our place in it. Creation is waiting breathlessly for each of us to take our place in it. He says that the world wants each of us to belong in a way that no one else can. So our true work is to become part of creation in a way that is uniquely ours, joining our one life-shaped piece to the puzzle that is the whole. For White, the process of becoming is also coming to know that there is what he calls a more spacious reality waiting for us than the ones we have created for ourselves. He talks about how life is a constant cycle of making a home in the world and then venturing out of it and making home again. And just when you think you have gotten things just right, there is a knock at the door. And we are being summoned again to some hard, brave new thing. Something that asks us and encourages us and sometimes demands of us that we participate more fully, more deeply, more courageously in life. White says becoming is like the last lines from D.H. Lawrence's poem, Song of a Man Who Has Come Through. The lines which read, "What is the knocking? What is the knocking at the door in the night? It is somebody wants to do us harm? No, no. It is the 3 strange angels. Admit them. Admit them." It is when we admit the strange angels who have come, usually uninvited, to our doors that our becoming unfolds. It is through the inevitable struggles and suffering and joys, the births and the deaths, the loves and the losses, that we become more truly ourselves. Like Mary Oliver, David White invokes wild geese. In a beautiful poem he wrote for a friend who was going through a terrible time and yet was also somehow becoming more fully himself. The poem is called The Journey. Above the mountains, the geese turn into the light again, painting their black silhouettes on an open sky. Sometimes everything has to be inscribed across the heavens so you can find the one line already written inside you. Sometimes it takes a great sky to find that first bright and indescribable wedge of freedom in your own heart. Sometimes with the bones of the black sticks left when the fire has gone out, someone has written something new in the ashes of your life. You are not leaving, even as the light fades quickly now. You are arriving. This past pandemic year has been a demanding teacher of us. And one of the lessons is that there is so much we are not in control of. Even the shape of our own lives is not always, maybe not often, of our own choosing. So much of life happens to us when we're busy making other plans. Our becoming is in how we respond, in how we meet those strange angels at our doors asking us to come outside, asking us to move into our grief and fear and delight, asking us to be brave, to be big, asking us to hold this difficult paradox that we are never finished, and yet we are also always enough. So I'm going to ask Lee to join me to sing our closing song.
We Shall Be Known is from the duo Ma Muse. It talks about the great turning, which is a term I love, from the writer and activist Joanna Macy. The great turning is our shift toward more life-sustaining future for all. It's the vision, it's the action, it's the commitment to a world in which we can all thrive. So please join us in singing from home.
We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle round to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we arrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love. We shall be known by the company we keep, by the ones who circle around to tend these fires. We shall be known by the ones who sow and reap the seeds of change alive from deep within the earth. It is time now. It is time now that we thrive. It is time we lead ourselves into the well. It is time now, and what a time to be alive. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning we shall learn to lead in love. In this great turning, we shall learn to lead in love.
Hey, we did it.
So I invite you to come on over to Zoom for coffee and conversation after the postlude music. The Zoom link will be on the screen. And Lee and I will both be there to greet you. But for now, I invite you to put a hand on your heart and with the other, reach out and know that we are connected, held together by strong and sturdy threads of love.
Go in peace. Be a blessing to this world.